Now let's move on to part two. Part two is on data collection. Regarding collecting data, there are several traditional methods for collecting that data. Some of these methods include observational study, survey, designed experiment, or simulation. An observational study is a data collection method where experimental units sampled are observed in their natural setting. Examples: a department store manager observing the gender of the customers. So, like, you know, the department store manager just stands in front of the doors and just writes down, okay, female, female, male, male, female, male, female, as people walk in. Of course, observational studies can be a little bit more invasive than this. For example, a doctor measuring the cholesterol level of patients by taking blood, that's still observational because he's still just observing the blood samples. He's not asking the blood samples, what blood type are you, or how high is your cholesterol level. He's observing this. So while surveys can be considered a specific type of observational study, most statisticians view this as a completely separate category. Because when you're asking somebody something, that's kind of a whole different dynamic than when you just observe it yourself. So let's move on to surveys. Surveys, also called questionnaires or polls, is an investigation of one or more characteristics of a sample. Surveys are frequently done by interviews, mail, online, or by telephone. While surveys are common data gathering techniques, they suffer from many sources of bias, such as people not answering truthfully or accurately, or certain people in the population just not responding. We'll explore more on this in a little bit. Another type of data collection technique is called a designed experiment. A designed experiment is a data collection method where the researcher exerts full control over the characteristics of the experimental unit sampled. These experiments typically involve a group of experimental units that are assigned to a treated and an untreated, or in other words, a control group. All right, I know that seems like a lot, but basically the idea of an experiment is all about control. You're trying to help establish a cause and effect relationship, and without exerting some kind of control over the situation, you really can't figure out what's the cause, what's the effect. To illustrate this, let's explore an example. So this is something I hear a lot, and I've heard many times that it is widely believed that drinking a glass of red wine each day will improve your health. Sometimes people say it lowers cholesterol or blood pressure. There's all kinds of supposed health benefits. This relationship can be seen in many surveys and many observational studies. It is backed up by data. On one of these surveys that showed that those that drink one glass of wine a day are healthier than those that do not drink at all. And that's pretty incredible. So in other words, the people that drink a little bit are healthier than the people that don't drink at all. So the conclusion that most people reach from this is that people should drink a glass of wine every day. I've heard similar studies regarding drinking dark beer. So can we truly conclude, though, that drinking a glass of wine each day will improve health based on an observational study or based on a survey? Well, let's think about it. Well, maybe not. Not necessarily. It could be that those that have health problems might be on medication that prohibit them from drinking any alcohol at all. I personally know several people that are in this situation that would love to enjoy a glass of wine, you know, here and there, but they can't because their medication prevents it. So maybe it's the poor health that causes the zero wine consumption due to consuming medicine if you're in, you know, somewhat poor health. So it might be poor health causes the zero wine consumption rather than the other way around, which is interesting. So we really don't know cause and effect just by doing a survey or just by doing an observational study. So if we were to design an experiment to test this relationship, we can actually maybe figure out what's the cause, what's the effect. We might select 90 random volunteers to participate, for example. 30 of those volunteers might be given zero glasses of wine and be in the zero glass treatment group, and then 30 might be given one glass a day and being put in that treatment group, and then maybe another 30 might be in the three glass per day group, for example. And then we can compare their cholesterol and blood pressure levels after 1 month. So continuing on, another type of study is called a simulation. A simulation is when the researcher uses mathematical or physical models to reproduce the conditions of a situation or a process. Usually this involves computers. It doesn't have to. You could use dice or something else instead, but usually computers are best suited to conduct a simulation. A simulation is usually less preferred than using real data, but it's often necessary when doing an experiment would just simply be too expensive or plain not ethical. For example, when Edward Thorpe, an MIT math professor, wanted to develop a winning blackjack strategy in the early 1960s, he used computers to simulate hundreds of thousands of hands of blackjack. If he wanted to develop this strategy in an actual casino, think about it. It probably would have bankrupted him. He was developing the strategy, so he didn't know what was right and what was wrong. It's much safer to make a mistake on a computer than to make it in real life in a casino. So if he was to develop his blackjack strategy, developing his blackjack strategy and card counting strategy using computers allowed him to not only save on a lot of potential losses that would have happened if he was risking real money, but also allowed him to develop the strategy much faster than he would have if he was playing in real time. So which data collection technique to use? Every data collection technique has its usefulness, and that's why people use all different kinds. So for each of the following, which sampling technique would you use? The first example, situation one, we want to analyze the rate at which a deadly virus would spread throughout New York City. What do you think? Okay, so I think that we should use a simulation, since it would be completely not ethical to analyze this by an experiment. Situation two, we want to see if oatmeal lowers cholesterol levels. So what do you think? Okay, if you notice here, we want to try to establish a cause and effect relationship. As such, an experiment would be, or a designed experiment, would be the most appropriate method to use. For situation three, we want to find the approval rating of a Florida congressman. Well, this would be a perfect situation for a poll or a survey. All right, so what is the purpose here? When we try to make a sample, we want that sample to be representative. What we mean by representative is that it exhibits similar characteristics to those typical of the characteristics possessed by the target population. So when we conduct a sample, ideally we would like that sample to be representative. One way to do this that will most likely produce a representative sample is to conduct what's called a random sample. There are other sampling techniques that can produce representative samples, but sometimes they work and sometimes they don't, where a random sample usually works. So what is a random sample? A random sample is a sample selected from the population in such a way that every different sample of size n has an equal chance of being selected. Before we move on, I'd like to make a comment here. When I say size n, n can be any number. It could be 30, it could be 50, it could be 100, it could be 1,000. N is just a symbol statisticians often use for sample size. We will continue using that same symbol throughout the course. And you'll see that very often throughout the course that we might start using the same symbols over and over again. Since we're defining sample size as N right now, you're not going to see that definition later on in the text. So it might be a good idea for you to just develop like one sheet of paper in a very obvious place, like just some notes on the symbols, like a symbol dictionary of sorts. This way you can keep track of what symbols mean what. So right now, maybe take out a piece of paper, write N is sample size. N sample size, and it has to be a lowercase n. All right, so going back, one way to conduct a random sample is to put the entire population's name in a hat, then pick out maybe 30 of those names or any size n that you would like from the hat. We don't really physically have to use a hat. It could be anything. For example, the Florida lottery, they pick six numbers randomly using a machine to randomly pick six numbers from the possible 53 numbers. They do this by writing, they have 53 balls and they write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc. on each of the, one number on each ball. So another way to randomly sample is to number everyone in every experimental unit in the whole population and then use a random number generator to pick from those numbers. So this might work really well for students because every student already has a student ID, and maybe I could randomly pick based off those student IDs.